calls for peace and justice growing louder in protests and vigils across the country.
After those devastating shootings, you see some rallies, like this one in Minnesota, did turn violent.
Thank you so much, Stefan. We begin south of the border. U.S. President Donald Trump is threatening to crack down on civil unrest as riots over George Floyd's death escalate in hundreds of cities.
I will deploy the United States military and quickly solve the problem for them. And yes, together, we will make America great again.
Hi. I haven't filmed, edited, or actually I have, okay, let's start this again. Let's start you up again. I haven't uploaded a video in like a month. I totally meant to, and I did film stuff, but I didn't like, how they turned out. All of the stuff that's, been happening like all weekend long has made me feel like I need to make this video, obviously, for obvious reasons, you know. If you can't already tell, this topic makes me, like, really angsty. Antsy? There we go. This topic makes me, like, really antsy and, like, nervous and, like, panic attacky, I guess. But I don't think I'm gonna have a full-blown panic attack, but I'll need to take, like, seconds to, like, breathe every once in a while, because, I don't know, just talking about this, it just, like, makes my heart start to palpitate, and then I'm like, and I can't breathe. It's not a full-blown panic attack, but it's just, like, it's a heavy topic, you know, and it brings a lot of not good memories, but whatever. So, on Saturday night, I think, yeah, Saturday night, I decided to impulsively cut my hair. I took out my extensions, and then I just kind of, like, went ham. I was like, get off, you know? And it just got me thinking about all the things that, like, have been an issue for me growing up, and all the things that have, like, been a bother, I guess, really, growing up. And then the George Floyd stuff happened, and the riots have been happening, and it's just, I need to talk. I need to talk. I need to have a talking session. So anyway, the whole point of this video, basically the, like, whole overarching, like, theme of this video is, like, accepting yourself for who you are and, like, being yourself. And that's why I'm here, like, bare natural hair, barefaced. I'm in, like, a pajama shirt. just giving you, like, as much naturalness as I can. I've seen a lot of people make videos about this. A lot of people of color make videos like this. A lot of people who aren't people of color making videos like this. And honestly, I think it's great. I think it's great that we finally have enough people bringing up the topic. And people with, like, big platforms bringing up the topic, too, because, like, it's important. Like, racism is important, and obviously it's fucking real. Like,
duh,
you know? I'm gonna be honest, I tried to film this video. I've already tried to film this video two times. I filmed it last night, and then I didn't like it, so I deleted that. And then I filmed it this morning, and the camera was out of focus, and that bothered me a lot, so I'm filming it for the third time, and I hope to God this is the last time. Fuck, I can't keep talking about the same stories. Like, I can't get heated anymore. I'm done. Like, I'm so exhausted, you know? I need to breathe. So what I wanted to bring up was what it was like for me growing up as a Black person, as a person of color, and dominantly, in not one, like, multiple dominantly white communities, you know, because I see a lot of people who talk about their experiences in, like, predominantly Black communities or, like, the ghetto or whatever, or people talking about their experiences where it's, like, an even split kind of between, like, white and Blacks. But I haven't seen a lot of videos of people who have had literally no one, like, absolutely no personal influence by, like, people of color. You know, like, obviously I've, like, had celebrities or, like, family, but that's like that's it. Like, celebrities, spokespeople, and family, that's literally all I had. Like, I literally made my first person of color friend like 6 months ago. I wish I was kidding, but I'm not. So it's just something that I really thought I should bring up, and I have lots of examples of, you know, racism, discrimination, and shit, and, you know, there's no point in pretending it doesn't exist anymore, or, like, hiding it, or, like, pretending that I'm not who I am, you know? Like, that's been a problem, and that's something that I've, like, struggled with for my whole life, so. I'm, like, sweating, Jesus, okay. I'm just gonna, like, start from the beginning, I guess, and just give you, like, an example of what my life has been like, so you know, like, you can have multiple perspectives of, like, the struggles of dealing with everyday systematic racism, because shit happens. Okay, so I was born in Africa, Zimbabwe, and I lived there until I was about 2.5, and that was the last time that I was in a, like, predominantly Black community or, like, person of color community. And then I moved to London, England, and I lived there until I was 7. Yeah, I lived there until I was 7. So I hadn't been in school in back home in Africa, but I started, like, really socializing with people in London. And so this is where I first, like, learned to survive, I guess, in predominantly white communities. So I started preschool, I think, when I was 3. Yeah, I started preschool when I was, like, 3. And from what I know, the preschool that I went to was, like, all white. Like, I was literally the only Black person, probably the only person of color at the preschool, because I have a lot of photos of me celebrating my birthday with my parents and, like, at the preschool. And, like, every single person behind me in the photos, they're all, like, not Black. They're not even people of color. Like, they're all, like, little white kids. So there's that. And then following that, I started kindergarten at 4. So by the time I was 7, I was in third grade, or I'd started third grade anyway. And I went to a school that was also, like, predominantly white. All the people that I interacted with were white, except for 2 of them. Where one was, like, mixed, like, she was, like, Black and something. Her name was Jade. She was Black and something. I don't remember what the something was, but, yeah. And then the other girl, what was her name? I don't remember what her name was, but she was Spanish. She was, like, Northern Spanish. It was, like, she was probably from, like, Spain or, like, Portugal or something. I don't know. And she went to my school, and oddly enough, she didn't like me. I didn't like her either. It was a mutual hatred. We did not like each other, but we coexisted. But this wasn't like a racist, not like thing. This was just like, I literally don't like you because XYZ. Like, you act like this and I don't like that. And that was the kind of relationship we had. And that's fine. Like, and you're not going to have everyone like you all the time. So, like, if you don't like me, it's fair and fine. Do whatever you want. Like, I don't care, you know? I'm gonna talk about the, like, contrast between London and Canada, because it's a big one. I was never ever bullied when I lived in England. Like, no one ever, like, bullied me. I don't even, like, remember instances of other people bullying each other. I think we were just too young to even, like, think of entertaining the idea. Like, I don't think we had gotten to the age where we were starting to, like, develop and figure out what we like and what we don't like and who we like and who we don't like. Enough to the point where, like, people would get bullied. Like, I don't think that was even, like, a thought that we had. Like, we were all, like, all of us were, like, friends. Like, all of us, except for me and that girl. But, like, we existed together, you know. So I'd never had any issues with anyone. No one had any issues with my color. We acted like we were just living in a society because, you know, that's what you should do. An equal society. My camera cut out. I don't know where it cut out, but I took a drink of water. And then I said that this was a very nervous topic for me because my throat is, like, getting dry. And I'm, like, sweating. Like, I'm sweating. And I can't breathe. Anyway. So, yeah. There was nothing ever wrong. Not really, like, no bullying, nothing bad, you know, nothing, like, racist really happening back then. But then I moved to Canada, I moved to Alberta, and, I had started third grade in London before I came here. Some, like, official, I don't know, said that she suggested to my parents that I should, be with people my age. Like, she said it'd be more comfortable for me to transition from like to a culture that I don't really know, that I'm not really familiar with, if I'm with people that are like my same age. And I had started kindergarten a year early, so I was in third grade. I was six and I was in third grade, but they were like, you should put her back in second grade so she can be with like, or I was seven and I was in third grade, you should put her back in grade two so that she can be with people her age. And then my parents were like, yeah, sure, whatever. So I had to redo second grade. That's where the problems started, let me tell you. I literally can't breathe. Like, I'm not even making it. So when I was in second grade, there were these two girls who took one look at me and decided that they didn't fucking like me. Like, they didn't, I hadn't said anything. I hadn't talked to them. I hadn't personally offended them in any way. I hadn't even had the chance to introduce myself. I wonder why. I just wonder why. Like, I wonder why it had to be me that they looked at and they decided that they didn't like, you know, school full of white people, absolutely no black person in sight. And they decided that they didn't like me, and I wonder why. Anyway, which is, like, it's how it is, I guess. That's what we're trying to change, but that's how it is. And so after that, they both went around telling all of the girls, there were two different classes, they went around telling all of the girls not to hang out with me, not to be nice to me, not to be my friend, not to acknowledge me as a person, because they didn't like me. And I didn't know this at all. The only reason I know now is because those girls are like my friends now. Like, we've grown up together, they're my friends now. And they've, like, come forward and been like, hey, like, just letting you know, like, when we were in second grade, I'm so sorry for treating you like that, like, you didn't deserve that, but so-and-so said that we should do this, or else, you know, the, like, I'm not gonna be your friend if you don't do this, like, you're not a real friend if you don't do that, like, the thing is, with these two girls, one of them doesn't bother me that much, because she really only was mean to me, like, then. And then she didn't really, like, she wasn't really, like, vindictive or anything. She just kind of didn't like me, and we ended up not going to the same high school, so I just don't care. I hope she's living her best life. I don't know, you know? But the other girl, she was quite possibly the spawn of Satan. Like, actually the spawn of Satan. She's the meanest person I've ever met in my entire life. She's so mean. She wasn't even, like, it wasn't like she was just mean to me. For example, when we were in second grade again, like, most of this stuff happened in second grade, but she used to sit behind this girl that had really long hair, and she used to glue, like, take Elmer's glue and glue dandelions that she found from outside in this girl's hair, and then when the glue dried, she would cut the fucking dandelions out of her hair and, like, cut her hair, sitting behind her just, like, snip, 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 art project, like, what kind of psychopath thinks like that? Like, who decides, like, I'm gonna glue dandelions into this girl's hair and then I'm gonna cut it? Like, leave her alone, you know? So annoying. And then when we were in fifth grade, she took someone's shoe, her and her friends took someone's shoe and threw it into the toilet and tried to flush it down the toilet because she had nothing better to do, obviously. Like, and the worst part is she got away with everything because her mom worked at the school. So no one ever did anything. Like, even if people would be brave enough to come forward, no one would ever do anything because her mom worked at the school. Anyway, I'm getting off my tangent, but I just had to, like, say, like, how mean people could be, not only to me, but, like, to other people. By the way, the kid whose shoe she flushed down the toilet was also not white, I don't think. Yeah, I don't think he was white. This leads me to my next example. Also, in second grade, I was hanging out with these girls. I won't really call it hanging out. We were eating lunch together in, like, the lunchroom or whatever, which is just the gym. We were eating lunch together, and I had brought home, or I'd brought a lunch from home, like a homemade lunch. And I guess it was, like, traditional food. I honestly don't even remember what it was that I'd brought, but I can say that it was traditional. And the second that I opened my lunchbox, the girls that I was with looked at it, and they were like, ew, like, what's that? And I was like, it's food. Like, I don't, it's food. And they're like, yeah, but like, why does it look like that? It's so disgusting. Like, why does it look like that? And I'm like, it's just food. Like, it doesn't matter what it looks like. It's still edible. And they're like, yeah, but it's like disgusting. Like, can you not eat that right now? Like, I'm going to throw up. And I literally like got up. I'm pretty sure I started crying, but I don't remember. I got up and I threw away not only the food, but the Tupperware that it was in and the lunchbox, because like in my mind, in my little like naive 7-year-old brain, I was like, this food is disgusting. It's contaminated. It's contaminating the Tupperware and it's contaminated the lunchbox, and I don't want that. Like, it's disgusting. Like, this homemade food is disgusting. Like, that was my mentality because of what these girls said. And then after that, to like add a cherry on top of the cake, I literally, when I went home, I can't breathe. When I went home, I screamed at my mom, screamed at her. I literally was like, I don't ever want to have that for lunch. Like, why would you do that to me? Why would you give it to me for lunch? Like, nobody likes this food, mom. I literally screamed at her. Imagine coming home from work and seeing your 7-year-old daughter scream at you because she doesn't like the food that you made her because some girls decided that that it was disgusting. That's so crazy to me. Like, and I didn't even see, like, I didn't even see that there was anything wrong with that as a, like, well, as a kid. Like, I didn't think that there was anything wrong with that. I thought that was okay. I thought that was just how people acted, when clearly it wasn't. And the sad thing is, like, I was a very, like, naive and easily trusting person as a kid. Like, I was very, very, very naive, like, way too naive to survive in the modern world. And, like, it's not like I wasn't sheltered or anything. Like, my parents always told me, like, you can't trust people as much as you do. Like, the world isn't like that. Like, I'm not, like, they weren't saying don't trust every single person you meet, but you can't trust everyone with your life immediately. You know, you gotta like test the water, see what they're like, see if they're gonna backstab you, see if they're even like good people, if they have morals, you know. And I just threw all that in the trash, and I was like, ah, people are good. Like, everyone's great. Like, we're just here to love, you know. There are people out there who are here for love, you know, but like, there are other people who are just awful. I can't breathe. I'm not trying to make a joke or do like a George Floyd thing, but I literally can't breathe. Like, I'm having a panic attack talking about this. Anyway, I went home, screamed at my mom for God knows how long. I still feel so bad about that. And I'm still to this day, like, I've never brought to school like any like traditional meal. Still to this day, I don't even know how to make traditional meals. That's how much it's affected my life. Like, that's how bad it is. And that makes me really sad because I should, you know, like, passing down the culture is important, you know, so it doesn't get lost or suppressed. This just connects to my next point, which is probably the most heartbreaking and something that I didn't really realize until I was 18, honestly. Like, literally last year, like, I didn't really realize this, but like, the things that people do, whether they're white or not, for the sake of like my examples, the villain of this story are white people, just because those are the only people I've ever really interacted with. But they don't have to be white. They can even be black people that are oppressing other people. They can be other people of color who are oppressing other people. It's just not very likely that it is normally, you know. But like, for the sake of these examples, the villain of the story are gonna be white people, Caucasian people, you know. But it makes me so sad that I turned my back on so many things because of how people would treat me and stuff they said to me. And like I said, as a kid, I was very, very naive. So every time that I got bullied, I never said anything. And unfortunately, that's like, I mean, bullying now is like seen as like a federal or provincial or whatever state crime, you know, but like back in the early 2000s, it wasn't like bullying, like wasn't even really a thing. It was kind of like nobody cared until someone died, really. And that's the sad, like, it's so heartbreaking that there was a time that I grew up that, like, when people got bullied, no one gave a fuck until someone died. And it's translating now. Like, nobody gave a fuck about Black rights until someone died, until someone was murdered. That's when people start caring. You have to wait for someone to die first before you care. You're not even really living. If you're suppressing yourself and you're suppressing who you are you really even living? You're like a shallow version of yourself. That's not life. That's not living. That's death right there. But it doesn't count unless your heart stops beating. But the thing that breaks my heart even more is there's a whole generation of little... I'm getting so... There's a whole generation of little boys and girls out there who are growing up and turning their backs on their roots because it's not seen as okay in society. Like, I never liked my hair. Hated my hair so much growing up as a kid. I could not stand it. I hated it so much. I did everything I could to cover up my hair because I used to cry myself to sleep because I'd see all of these girls that have this long, beautiful, straight hair, and I'd be like, why can't I have that? Like, why can't I be like that? I'd see all of these light-skinned girls and be like, why is my skin so dark? Like, am I burnt? Like, what is this? Like, why can't I be like all of these other girls that I go to school with? Like, they're so much better than me. They're so much prettier than me. And no one, like, ever stopped to, like, turn and show me, like, you're beautiful too, you know? Like, it's just, it's so heartbreaking that, like, not only that I had to experience that, but other people had to experience that, and there are people still experiencing that today, you know? Like, it's just the worst thing in the entire world. And it took me, like, 18 years to, like, really accept myself for who I am, you know? Like, just because you don't look like someone else doesn't mean you're less than. Just because other people treat you like you're less than doesn't mean you are, you know? And, like, it makes me so sad that, like, this is a lesson that little kids have to learn so quickly, you know? You have to learn to not love yourself before you can really love yourself, you know? You have to learn to turn your back on yourself before you can accept who you are. And it's just so heartbreaking. Fast forward to, like, when I was older, not much older, so one important thing I need to say, now my town, the town that I grew up in, has, like, younger people coming in every day. It's, like, different generations, but, like, when I first moved here, this town was pretty much for, like, old people who wanted to retire. It was literally a place where people came to die, honestly. Like, that was just, like, a subtle little town where it's not quite a city, but it's also not quite the country. So, yeah. But as I grew up and spent a lot of time with older people, predominantly, like, older white people, I've learned that there's like, mostly, I'm not saying everyone's like this, but they're, like, mostly in this town, there are, like, two different groups of, like, older people. And I've made this joke before, but, like, now it's, like, more serious, you know? Like, there are the, like, sweetest, like, nicest little, like, elderly people that are just angels, honestly. They're beautiful, they're perfect, they're so accepting. Like, they'll walk down the street and they'll see me and they'll smile and they'll wave and then they'll be about their day, or they'll stop me and we'll have a conversation, you know? Like, that's nice. But then there are other elderly people who just cannot fathom the idea of someone with darker skin being alive and sitting next to them. Like, God, like, they look at me when I'm by myself and they just see this, like, searing hatred growing on their face, like, absolute hatred. And it's just, you know, something that you have to deal with. Like, when someone's staring at you, your initial instinct is to be like, why are you staring at me? Like, is there something on my face? Like, is there something you want to tell me? And, like, even if I was to be like, why are you staring at me? They'd be like, no reason, nothing. And I'm like, then why would you be, you know? Like, you have no answer to that question. Most of these examples, like, because I've lived in white communities for so long, I've kind of learned how I should act and how I should be without pulling a lot of attention to myself and like causing a commotion, really. So I don't like the racist actions are usually like very, very subtle, but I still notice them. I can tell the difference between someone just looking at me because they're just looking at me and someone just looking at me because they don't approve of me or my skin color, you know? It's pretty easy to pick up on after a while. But anyway, this is, it's not even like something that just happens with like older people. Like I'm in university now and I still have this happening to me every single day. Like, for example, I have to do a little backstory. I'm from Alberta, as I said, and it's not uncommon for 16, 17, 18-year-olds to have cars in Alberta. It's not uncommon, because back in the day when people used to have their kids working on the farm, they'd need to get their license so they can operate vehicles, right? So it's not uncommon for younger kids to have vehicles. Because of that, like, I've never really had to deal with public transport as much. Like, it's just not something that I've had to deal with. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah. So when I went to university for the first time, I left my car behind, obviously, because I was living on campus. Like, food is right there for me. Everything I need pretty much is right there. It's a walking distance away. And if I need to go further, they have public transport that works perfectly fine. Unlike my town that I grew up in, when there's absolutely no, I mean, there's kind of a bus system now, but there wasn't one while I was growing up. So you either found a ride or you walked. Those were your only two options. You either found a ride or you walked. The funny thing, it's not funny, like, haha, like, just weird. The funny thing is, when I sit on the bus, like, normally, because, like, the university, the loop for the university is, like, the beginning and end of the whole, like, system loop for whatever bus system you're on. So when I get on the bus, I'm usually, like, the first or the second person on the bus, you know. And normally, I just, like, sit in the corner because you're, first of all, I sit in the back because you're supposed to fill up public transport from, like, the back to the front, or buses, at least, you fill them up from the back to the front. So I usually just, like, sit in the corner, you know, minding my own business, not bothering anyone, not doing anything, not dressed like a thug or dressed like someone who could murder, someone who could commit a crime, you know, because when you have a hood on, instantly you become a criminal, right? Anyway. And I noticed that no one will sit next to me unless they absolutely have to. So, like, I'll sit in the corner of the bus, and people will be going to stops, will be going wherever, and people will file in, fill up the bus, and they'll sit everywhere else on the bus, or even stand. Like, some of them won't even sit, they'll just stand. They won't even stand near me until the seat next to me is the only seat that's left open, and people are forced to sit there. Normally, the person that happens to sit next to me is, like, probably a person of color, so, like, they're probably, like, Asian, and you know, whatever, blah, 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 and not, like, a Caucasian, like, white person. But I'm not just blaming, like, white people for not sitting next to me on the bus. Like, it's not just them. Like, it's, like, anyone who gets on the bus won't sit next to me. I don't see a lot of black people because there just aren't a lot of black people on the island. There are literally just not a lot of black people on the island. Like, me seeing another black person, I'm like, you exist. I thought I was the only one, you know? So, yeah. But, yeah, and it's just weird that nobody wants to sit next to me. But they'll sit next to Sally and Susie and Janet and Karen because I guess they seem less threatening or less different than I do, you know? But if I'm with my friends, who again is like are mostly white, except I did make one black friend. Shout out to you, Tia. Thank you for being my first black friend. Like, I love you. Whenever I'm sitting with my other friends who are also like mostly white, then people will sit next to me. Like, that's just so fucked up to me. That's so weird. Like, by myself, they're like, oh, she's dangerous. Like, let's not sit next to her. But then when I'm with my white friends, they're like, oh, so, like, she hangs out with white people. Okay, so she's, like, safe. Like, that doesn't make any sense. Does that make any sense? The same can be said for when I sit in a 300-seat giant-ass lecture hall where, again, there's not that many black people. Like, I think in my, I took 10 classes this year. my first year of university, I took 10 classes. Only one of my classes, one of the 10 classes that I took, had another Black person in that class. Like, that's crazy to me, first of all. But if I sit by myself, even if I'm sitting dead center in the middle of the lecture hall where more people want to sit because you want to be able to see the prof from all angles, that makes sense. I'm sitting dead center in the lecture hall. People will fill out from like the outside in until they have to sit next to me, like white, Asian, Indian, Middle Eastern, whatever. Like they will fill out from the outside in until they have to sit next to me. But if I'm with like one of my white friends and I'm sitting dead smack in the middle, then they'll sit next to me and fill out that way. Like, that doesn't make any sense to me. Like, that's so messed up. But it still happens. Like, that's so messed up. And it still happens to me every single day. And like, the funny thing, again, not funny, haha, just like weird, is that people don't even realize that they're doing it. They just do it because they've been subliminally trained by this system and this society to think that there has to be some kind of separation between one person of one skin color and another person of another skin color. Like, whether you think you're actually doing it or not, it still happens. And another thing that I thought of, or not thought of, but just someone, like, a lot of people talk about it on Twitter, and I just, like, I think about it every once in a while, and I'm like, that's so messed up. And actually, like, really pisses me off. And it has to do with articles and, like, titles. So when people are writing headlines for articles, they obviously try to write, like, the most catchy headline that they can think of to, like, draw you in. So you, like, read it, you know? But the way that they do it between white people and Black people, like, for example, let's say that they're talking about, like, Kylie Jenner or someone, you know? Like, Kylie Jenner is white, you know, as we all know. And I'm not gonna talk about her like billionaire, not billionaire conspiracy, but like, for the sake of this example, I'm just gonna use like Kylie being a billionaire as like the title. And in the title, they will say, like, how old was she? Like 21. Like, 21 year old Kylie Jenner becomes billionaire. Or like, Kylie Jenner is a billionaire. Like, Kylie Jenner, billionaire. Kylie Jenner, blah, 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 blah. Whatever they're talking about her. But then on the flip side, if they're talking about like a person of color or like a Black person, they'll say, like, let's say like a doctor saves a life, they'll say, Black doctor saves life. African American individual saves life. Say his fucking name, dude. Say his fucking name. His skin color has absolutely nothing to do with his ability to save a life or not. Even if it was a white person, say their fucking name. You know, they earned that title. Dr. Blank saved a life. Don't say Black person saved a life. And like, listen to this. Like, really just sit down. You can close your eyes if you want. But listen to this. If you heard someone say to you, Black man saves life. That's not that bad, you know? Like, you listen to that, you're like, whatever, like, you know? But if you ever heard someone, or if you ever read a title that said, white woman saves life, like, that doesn't make any sense. Like, you'd question it, you know? Like, you'd question it. If you read a title, you read an article that says, white woman saves life. Like, doesn't that just sound weird in your head? Like, hearing white woman saves life, you're like, what? Why don't you just say her name? Like, why the fuck does her skin color matter? But if you hear Black man saves life, that doesn't sound wrong in your head, does it? Exactly. That's where the system went wrong. Like, that's crazy to me. Like, I thought about that the other day and I was like, wow. So this is where we are, huh? And like, with the George Floyd stuff that like sparked this revolution. Well, it didn't spark this revolution. This revolution has been happening for hundreds of years, but like, now we have social media. Will Smith said, okay, sorry, my SD card ran out of space, but I was saying, Will Smith said that racism isn't getting worse, it's just being documented now. And I was like, damn, like, you're right about that. Like, absolutely nothing has changed. Absolutely nothing has changed. A lot of people still have the same mentality that they had 50, 60, 100 years ago. Like, not much has changed. It's just, it's insane. I don't even know, like, the second time that I was filming this, I started talking about a theory that I had about leaders and, like, world leaders. Because I guess I was like, I was talking about Donald Trump and I got really mad, but like, I'm so over talking about Donald Trump because nothing I say will ever change his mind about anything. So I just, I'm done. I'm done with that man. He's not even a man. He's a boy. He's a child. I'm done with him, you know? But I had a theory that I personally don't believe that business people should be allowed to be world leaders or politicians. I think they have absolutely every right they want to address the media, lobby, participate in politics and the election and all that. Absolutely. Like, you have that right as a citizen. You have that right. I can't breathe. But I believe that successful business people should not be world leaders. And I'll go deeper into it. So my problem with successful business people is their whole, their success literally comes from leaping over someone else. Like, you can't be a successful business person without leaping over someone else, jumping over someone else, proving yourself to be better than or stronger than someone else. That is what business is. That is how you be successful, at least in a capitalist society. Like, that's how it works. That's why we have the 1% and the 99%. It's because there's always going to be someone who has to be better than someone else, or else the system falls apart, you know? I mean, the system is built like that. It's built to have people be better than other people. That's just how it thrives, you know? And that's how you be a successful business person in society. But those are not the qualities that we need for world leaders. We need world leaders and politicians who, A, want, obviously, whatever is best for their nation or their people, their citizens, people that are not their citizens, people that are living in their country, but also who want the best for other countries as well, and, like, can grow together as a community. Like, that's what we want for world leaders, so that the world is, like, at balance, at peace, you know? But business people, their mentality just can't be like that. And I'm not saying that, like, all successful business people are like the spawn of Satan. They have no emotions. They don't feel anything. They don't feel empathy. I always say entropy. They don't feel empathy, you know? Like, there's some business people out there who are literally the sweetest, kindest, nicest people in the world. They care about all people of color. They care about white people. They care about everyone. They care about the world. They care about the environment. They care about everything, you know? Like, they really, like, feel things, you know? And they want what's best for society. But at the end of the day, to become successful, you had to leap over someone at some point. Whether you chose to, whether you didn't choose to, whether you acknowledge that you did it, whether you didn't even know that you did it, you always have to leap over someone to be successful, at least in a capitalist society. Like, that's how it was built, you know? And that's why I don't think that they should be politicians, world leaders. Obviously, you have the right to have your voice be heard and speak out about what you think is wrong and speak out about your opinions and whatever and voice who you are, whatever. You obviously have that right, but I just don't think that they should be like that. That's why, like, psychopaths and, like, sociopaths make the best, like, business people, is because they don't feel empathy. They don't feel bad for other people. They don't really feel emotions, you know? They're emotionless. They don't care who they have to, like, trample over to get what they want, you know? It's just not, like, their brain isn't wired that way. Their brain isn't wired to feel bad for other people when they step over someone or they get to the top, you know? They keep climbing. That's, like, their mentality. Like, imagine if you had, like, a sociopath or, like, a psychopath running a country. Like, they wouldn't care about anyone but themselves. They wouldn't care about their citizens. They wouldn't care about other people in the other world, you know? That's just a theory I had, you know? Like, if you want to, like, debunk me or, like, oppose me, go right ahead. Like, you're entitled to your own opinion. That's what this whole thing is about, is us finally having a conversation between, like, the two sides of the rift, where there's people who accept people of color and people who don't accept people of color. We have that conversation, we sit down, because we've tried talking, nobody fucking listens. We've tried marching, parading, you know, like, nobody fucking listens. And now we've been forced to resort to, like, violence and riots and all of this stuff, and still no one is fucking listening, you know? Like, what more do we have to do? It's like going back to the whole bullying thing. Like, no one will do anything until someone dies, until someone's murdered. Like, that's not the mentality that we want to have, you know? And the thing that pisses me off, like, a lot of things piss me off, obviously, about this topic, but, like, specifically with George Floyd's case, the police officer who was standing on his neck, there were obviously other police officers, or two other police officers who were kneeling on his body, and there were other police officers who were just standing there not doing anything, and there was footage released of him being, like, roughed up before he was thrown to the ground, you know. But the thing that really annoys me is the man who was on top of Floyd's neck, when he was like, I can't breathe, like, please get off, I just need some water, like, get off, like, I can't breathe, you know. That man, this is not the first time that he has been involved in the murder of a person of color, or involved in something against people of color, or oppressing people of color. This is not the first time. This isn't his first kill. This isn't the first time he's murdered someone. And the court really thinks that they can get away with just charging him with second and third degree murder. Like, if it was a black man who, I bet if he didn't even, like, kill someone, they would still give him first degree murder. You know? Like, that's how the world is, and it's so unfortunate. But, like, this is the one time that man is being forced to atone for his crimes, and he's not even, like, fully atoning for them. Like second and third degree murder is so, like, not, like, he needs to be charged for first degree murder, because he did kill someone. Like, whether it was an accident or whatever, he killed someone, point blank. And there's video evidence proving that it wasn't an accident. And, like, second and third degree murder insinuate that there was, like, accidental murder, like manslaughter or something. But that wasn't manslaughter. That was just straight up murder. Like, he killed someone, like, end of. And he deserves to go to jail for this crime and all the other crimes that he had before him. And unfortunately, he is the, like, poster child for cops at this moment. Like, right now he's acting as the poster child for cops, which really sucks, because there are some phenomenal, magnificent police officers out there who really are becoming police officers because they want to protect the people of their city. They want to protect people. They want to make sure people feel safe, you know? And, like, stuff like this, it doesn't make people feel safe. It makes people feel like they have no one to turn to, like they have nothing left, you know? And that really sucks, and that's not fair. Black, white, orange, green, purple, yellow, it doesn't matter. You should feel safe in your country, you know? Especially in a Western country where we have so many resources and we have so much just, like, handed to us for just living in the West. And it's, like, not safe. Like, it's just, it's so sad. It's so heartbreaking. It's so sad. It's depressing. It's disappointing. But yeah, I don't really have anything more to say on this topic, I don't think. I think I've said my piece. I think I've said all that I really meant to say to, like, start this conversation from my end. I'm sure there's, like, more that I want to say, and there's, like, I could go on for days about everything and anything that's happened, but, like, I just needed to, like, scrape the top of the barrel and just start something from my side, because all weekend long people have been rioting, starting the discussion, doing what they can, bringing their voice out, being heard, and I just think that it's phenomenal. I mean, I don't agree with the radical rioting that's been happening. I don't agree with violence at all, whether it's from us or them, which sucks that now we're in an us and them complex, which has never been good. Like, World War I, World War II, any war has shown us that the us and them complex, it never helps, it never works, you know, but that's where we are right now, is it's an us and them complex, which really sucks. But I'm not for violence in any way. Like, peaceful protesting is all we want, you know, just being peaceful is where we want to be, but when you're peaceful, no one listens to you. I'm not going to edit this video too much. Like, I'll try my best to, like, cut it down, but I think everything that I said is important enough that it shouldn't be cut down very much, you know. If people are willing to sit through and listen to it, then they will. And if they don't, and they only get, like, the beginning of what I said, at least it does something, you know. Like, you don't have to sit here and listen to this whole thing, but, like, if you have the time and you have the chance, I suggest you do. I mean, by the time you got to here, you already have, so. Yeah. Thank you for watching this video. Thank you for listening to me talk. God, I hope that it was in focus, because if it's not, I'm sorry, I'm not changing it. And yeah, hopefully my next video will be a lot happier and a more softer topic. I don't even know what my next video is going to be, but something will happen. So, bye.